Assalamu alaikum. You're watching Views and News, and I'm Faisal Rehman, live from our Islamabad studios. Ladies and gentlemen, today we'll be talking about some very interesting topics, and one is about the new emerging world order. We'll also be talking about this very important seminar on global strategic threat and response that was held in Islamabad. We'll also be talking about the kind of changes the region is witnessing, the whole globe is witnessing, what is happening in the Middle East in particular. Now we'll also be talking about the BRI and CPEC in general, as they are believed to be the game changers in this particular region. But still, we believe that certain countries have certain reservations about it. We'll definitely talk about that as well. The climate change is one of the major global challenges at the moment. So we'll be talking about that in detail today in our program. And obviously, when we talk about the Afghan peace process, is it derailed? Will it be derailed? Or people should be hopeful that at the end of the day, because a lot of countries, they got involved, a lot of stakeholders are there, and it seems that there is some sort of a way forward, provided certain issues are taken care of. And obviously, last but not the least, is about the Pakistan-India situation in particular, Kashmir, and the ongoing violence in all the major cities of India after the CA, the Citizen Act, which was based about a few months there, and it was immediately approved by the Lower House and then by the Rajya Sabha also in India, and that has created a lot of fear among the minorities, in particular among the Muslims. And so far, around 84 people have been killed, more than 350 have been injured. As far as the properties are concerned, countless properties, movable and immovable, they have been set on fire. And when you talk about the shops or the businesses, the way they were torched, I mean, that is again something of prime concern. So where exactly are we heading? The future challenges and the post 9/11 scenario. Now, this is going to be the topic of our discussion today. Let me introduce you to our very interesting panelists. We have with us in our studio the former Air Chief Marshal, Kaleem Sadat Saab. He is also the president of CASS. So thank you very much for taking out your time and being here. And we also have with us Cameron Munter. He's the former US ambassador to Pakistan, especially during the time when a lot was happening between Pakistan and United States of America. Whether you talk about the 2nd May incident where Osama bin Laden was killed, or you talk about the November 2011 incident in Salalah, where around 27 Pakistan soldiers were killed. And then the most important was about Raymond Davis. And then we all know what happened after that. Thank you very much, Excellency, for your time as well. Now, sir, starting off from you, obviously, sir, let's throw light on the CASS. I've been there when it was inaugurated, and now we have heard that a lot has been done in this regard, sir. Let's talk about the topic and the importance and the significance of that, sir.
Well, as the name suggests, Center for Aerospace and Security Studies. Security is an all-encompassing problem, and there are various facets of security. So we were seized with the problem. We wanted to project it into the future as to what are the challenges that will take place in the future as far as the security is concerned. So by habit, we Pakistanis are not adept at looking into the future. So this was an effort made to project things into the future and take help of people.
Forecasting primarily, sir.
Yes, and take help from people who have been here before, you know, the developed countries who are into this business of forecasting or predicting the future or even designing a future. So like it is said that, you know, all crises, etc., will not be what as they have been in the past. You know, they evolve, they change, they move ahead. So it is useful to predict, to anticipate the future crisis that can take place. So that was the whole exercise that for which we had this conference, and we had the benefit of 9 foreign speakers. It was a very interesting event. And till the last day, the hall was full. You know, there was not a seat empty. So
I think that was an amazing achievement, sir. And a lot of people from various think tanks are also a part of the CASS, sir. And I'm sure a lot has been done. And I believe, sir, this should have been, in fact, in place much earlier. But as long as you have done it, I think it's something which should be definitely talked about. But now, Excellency, threats, global threats, regional threats. Interestingly, Pakistan is situated at a place, it's a blessing in disguise in a way. When you talk about the geographic location, I mean, if you capitalize on that, Pakistan is one of the best countries. But having said that, if you look at the current scenario, problem in Iran, post P5+1, then you have got Afghanistan, 18-19-year-old war. Now things are settling down. Still, a lot of spoilers are playing their role. And talking about India, sir, again, issues with India. Don't you think now, since the Americans, they have a very clear-cut tilt and shift towards the Indians, that the balance of power has changed and will further change, sir? Your take.
First of all, I'd like to thank Cass for doing this, because it's the kind of thinking that not only Pakistan benefits from, but the region benefits, and indeed those of us who come to visit learn much more about what's going on. So it was a really excellent conference in that way. Part of what I think is changing is the perception of what a threat is. And the way you described it very, very accurately is as if there is a geographical set of issues, an issue that has to do with Iran, Afghanistan, an issue that has to do with India. I think one of the ways that Cass is being foresighted is to think there are also different problems. In addition to the countries, there are different problems. The three that I identified that I think are the greatest threats to Pakistan are climate change, the prospect for how climate change will affect the relationships over the long term with its neighbors. The second is the question of governance, the question of whether countries like Pakistan, every country has difficulties with governance. Are the problems in Pakistan going to be manageable, and is Pakistan going to be able to be strong and influence with a strong internal governance? And the third is technology. That is to say, not only the technology of warfare, which is important, the question of hypersonic weapons and cybersecurity, but the more difficult questions of biotech and the way that economies work. So this is not meant to avoid your question about what about Iran, what about India, what about Afghanistan. But I think in the long term, part of what is changing in the post-9/11 world, and we can say the post-post-9/11 world, 20 years after 9/11, is that the problems are defined differently. And I urged in the meeting for the leaders of Pakistan to look at these functional issues in addition to the regional and geographical ones.
So according to your formal, one of the presidential candidates, Mr. Al Gore, climate change is a much bigger threat as compared to the war on terror or terrorism as such. Mm-hmm. Do you agree with that, sir?
Well, one of the great tragedies in American history, in my mind, was that we had a very close election in the year 2000. And Al Gore, who was a very forward-thinking leader, especially on climate change, came close to being our president, but wasn't our president. So that during those years after that, we took our eye away from climate change when we could have made a difference. Now, when we look at our friends in Pakistan and we say, is Pakistan a secure country? We have had 20 years, perhaps, of not doing what we might have done. For example, to talk about the future of water, the relationship of India and Pakistan through the medium of water and how you get along and where it's coming from the glaciers of China. This is an international issue, a security issue, which can't just be defined by relations with Afghanistan or India. It's an international issue. And as you mentioned, I wish America had moved more quickly many years ago.
So even now, there seems to be a lot of problem post Paris summit. Mm-hmm. I mean, the way we all thought the Americans would engage themselves with this kind of issue, they have not, unfortunately. Right. And we wish that the future do. So talking about the regional changes, talking about the balance of power. Recently, sir, there were reports that during the visit of the American president, two-day visit, when he was in Delhi, we heard that the Americans would be selling the Seahawk helicopters, 24 of them, maybe six Apaches, and they'll be also manufacturing. We also heard about the manufacturing of F-21s at some stage. You talk about S-400, you know, buying those from the Russians, buying a lot of technology and equipment from the Israelis, and then Rafael deal with the French. So the kind of influence they have over those countries, because these are the economic deals, money matters at the end of the day. Don't you think, sir, the entire region is under some sort of a threat? Because looking at the Indian hegemonic design in the blue waters also and otherwise, is that a potential threat, sir?
Definitely. In fact, in my opening remarks, I highlighted this point, and I drew the attention of the audience and, of course, our guests, that the release of the whatever deals you do with India on trade or release of technology, if it increases the gap between Indian and our power potential, it tends to make India arrogant, you know.
And Pakistan more vulnerable.
And Pakistan more vulnerable. And I cited the example of 1998 between the nuclear explosion that they did and we did, you know. The rhetoric was at a different pitch before 28th May and after 28th May. Similarly, the 30 hours on 26th of February last year, you know, after they had struck Balakot, they were on top of this world, you know, as if, you know, they were expecting that Pakistan doesn't have the plan or the courage to respond. And so they were trying to present to their media that, you know, we have taken care of the problem. But when we responded, you know, everything disappeared. So it indicates that whenever they apparently have an edge over us, it tends to make them, you know, display their hubris.
Show the muscle strength.
Yes. So, as was highlighted by another speaker during the conference today, that the setbacks that they have suffered or they have not performed according to the expectations of their public, especially in terms of their Air Force's performance, they are itching to take revenge, you know. And how can revenge be taken if they have assurance, you know, that they can inflict a lot of damage without suffering any losses, you know. So this acquisition of high-tech weapon systems like the F-21 or Rafale and S-400, etc., are links in the same chain, you know, to get that decisive edge to be able to strike back at Pakistan and take care of what may have been an embarrassment in the past.
Sir, another article which I read about the Indian Air Force, now they are also planning to, I mean, the domestically made Tejas, they'll be using those on the aircraft carriers, and that is also going to definitely give them an edge. And then on top, sir, they have also you know, stationed their Su-30s with some modern technology to look after the affairs in the waters on the seaside, sir, in the Arabian Ocean as well as Arabian Sea and the Indian Ocean. Now, when you see this, these kinds of developments, sir, and especially when you compare our military or you know, the budget allocated for the defense, primarily, it seems to be a lot lesser than that of India, sir. I mean, they are one of the biggest purchasing weapon purchasing country in the world at the moment, sir. Now, these things go unnoticed, despite whatever is happening inside India, sir. And this is also something of prime concern, that nobody talks about it. I mean, you talk about the P5 countries, sir. Look at these statements of the French in favor of India, because again, you're talking about a deal. Americans, again, Russians, they have their own concern. Except for the Chinese, mostly, they are favoring the Indians. Don't you think that has also sort of created an imbalance? The equilibrium has been disturbed again, sir, when we present these two countries.
Well, actually, there is a disparity between our defense budgets because of the size of the economy in both the countries. You know, India is a much larger, it can defray much more as compared to Pakistan. So, I mean, we perhaps can't grudge that. The world understands, it's not that they don't understand, they understand, but there are other considerations of so-called national interests, you know, because of which they do not respond as we expect them to respond, because they have their own stances and they have their own interests. So at times it appears that, you know, it is an unfair world, but it has always been unfair, you know. Whatever the Indians do, they do it because they think it is in their best interest. So what we have to do is to do those things, you know, which are in our best interest. And I believe that if we can set our economy, etc., in order, I believe that considering the poverty on either side of the border, it is much easier to turn around a country of 220 million than to turn around a country of 1.3 billion people, you know. So we have an opportunity, or we have the possibility of catching up with them, you know, by improving the living standards of our people, make it the security of the people above the security of the state, and that will help us better.
That will definitely change the dynamics. Now, sir, let's talk about CPEC. Excellency, there is a concern among most of the Pakistani people that for some reason the Americans want to sabotage the CPEC project. They are opposing it. Miss Alice Wells was in Pakistan. She condemned And she said, well, Pakistan should think twice about it. And, you know, there's a concern prevailing. But at the same time, sir, a lot of people believe, a lot of leaders of the region believe that CPEC is going to be a game changer. Look at the amount of investment by the Chinese, and that is going to improve our infrastructure, our energy resources, and so on and so forth. Even the railway lines would be improved. So for most Pakistanis, they believe that Chinese are our friends and they're really helping us in every aspect. Whereas the Americans now, they have left us and they're more inclined towards the Indians. Do you see this alignments are being changed, sir? Or this is just temporarily for the time being?
Well, you know, you mentioned this narrative that the Pakistanis have about the Americans. They come when they help us, when they're interested, whether it's against the Soviets, whether it's against, you know,
they use us. This is the perception.
They use us, yes, and then they run away. The Americans have a different narrative.
And
the American narrative is we give them money and they use it in ways they're not always honest with us. Both of these narratives are very negative and very corrosive, because what it means is that the Pakistanis tend to believe the Americans will betray them, and the Americans tend to believe that the Pakistanis are not always being honest. What it's time for, in my opinion, as a friend of Pakistan, is for a more honest dialogue where we can actually talk about those kinds of issues, in my opinion, issues like in the environment, issues like proliferation, issues that we have in common, so we can build, not only with Pakistan, but with Pakistan's neighbors, a more useful kind of dialogue that doesn't get caught through the lens, which in my opinion has been too much focused on military and terrorism. I agree very much with the statement that the issue for Pakistan with its neighbors and how it can most effectively be influential is through domestic reform. If Pakistan can work on the kinds of things that will make its economy strong, to unleash the very strong potential of its people, the young people here who are working in leading sectors, that's what will make Pakistan able, I think, to defend itself, as you said very eloquently, to do for Pakistan what is in Pakistan's interest is primarily internal. As for the CPEC question, I take a little bit of issue with that. I don't think America is interested in sabotaging CPEC. America is skeptical about CPEC.
But their statements were pretty anti-CPEC.
But I would say skeptical about whether CPEC is good for Pakistan. And I agree with you. That is a decision for Pakistanis to make. But what we, the friends of Pakistan, want is that Pakistan is very careful when it makes deals, because American assistance is aid. We give money to Pakistan. We have given billions of dollars to Pakistan. When I was ambassador, my aid budget was $1.5 billion per year on civilian aid alone. This was money, boom, we gave it to you. The Chinese don't do that. They give you loans, and loans are fine.
Long-term loans. Low interest
right.
rate.
But you will have to pay them back. So I urge you, and I think this is what Alice Wells is saying, please pay attention to the fine print, because Pakistan, let's face it, has a problem raising money. Fiscal issues, taxation, that's a problem in Pakistan that needs to be addressed. If you don't do that, don't expect the IMF to bail you out in 20 years to pay off your CPEC loans. So this is the constructive criticism of CPEC. I think the idea of working on your infrastructure, no one can deny. Getting power, getting roads, getting pipelines, that'll be good for Pakistan.
Now, another area, sir, I mean, when we talk about the training of military forces, sir, whether you talk about Air Force or Army or otherwise, America is the area where they used to go, and they would have their courses done there and everything. And then there was this statement again from Mr. Donald Trump that no more money. I remember exactly 14 months ago, there was a statement on the 1st of January 2019 that $33 billion were given to Pakistan and we have done this. And, you know, most of that money went back in the form of the services which the Americans were offering. And on top of that, other than that, sir, if you look at the kind of sacrifices which Pakistan has made, Mr. Munter, you were here as an ambassador at that particular time period when we witnessed a lot of sort of, you know, this engagement really wasn't there. I mean, you talk about Salalah, you talk about 2nd May incident, you talk about the supply route which was stopped at a certain stage. I mean, that was the time when the relationship started to get eroded.
Yeah, I mean, one of the problems that I agree, one of the things that I agree on with Mr. Trump is that assistance in and of itself is not necessarily a good thing. Assistance has a psychological element to it that sometimes has, over time, in my mind, developed a kind of a resentment from Pakistan that the Americans think they can come, they can give money, and they expect something in return. I think what is called for is a mutual respect and a mutuality of the relationship that I'd like to see through the development of business ties, academic ties, conferences like what we have at CAS, so that we have a level field that's not based on one side giving the money and the other side not giving the money. Now, in the broader sense of things, I think that the American approach under President Trump is different, and not just different with Pakistan, different around the world. This so-called America First, which is a new departure for the United States, means that America is no longer trying to have these kind of strategic ideas, whether you agree with them or not, the kind of ideas that I worked on, for example, with Mr. Richard Holbrooke when he was coming, the strategic dialogue, these kinds of things. That is less of interest to Mr. Donald Trump, and American interest is more of interest to them. That makes things, for a traditional diplomat, more difficult. But I think to understand America, to understand the end of assistance, you should look at his politics and his domestic politics to understand he's not just doing this with Pakistan, he's doing this around the world.
Now, Afghanistan, sir, the latest development, a lot of round of talks in Doha, sir, very fruitful this time. And the Americans signed a deal with the Taliban, and all those who were once the most wanted ended up being a part of that delegation, interestingly. Good enough, as long as peace prevails in Afghanistan, sir, we support that. The role of Pakistan has been very critical, sir, very important, and we have ensured the American president when the prime minister was in U.S. and met that we'll do whatever we can, and we have delivered. Do you think, sir, this is the time that the relationship between these two countries should improve now? Because I fail to understand whether we are strategic partners, we are friends, or we are transactional partners. Where do we stand exactly, sir?
You mean with the United States?
With the Americans, USA and Pakistan, sir.
Ambassador Mentor has explained it, you know, how it works, how it used to work, how the diplomacy used to work in the time of the earlier presidents, and how it works with the present one. So, it's a matter of perceptions, you know. After 9/11, when the Americans wanted logistics, you know, space from us, I happened to fly with the team that was going around Pakistan. And at that time, you know, because now they were again coming back, the J5 team, the people were quite uncomfortable because, you know, now there was yet another time when they wanted our assistance, you know. And one of them also mentioned, why is there anti-Pakistan, anti-American feeling in Pakistan? I said, it's just a perception that people think that the American governments, they have nothing against the people of America as such, that the American governments do things that are inimical, that they think to the interests of Pakistan, you know? And while the Chinese don't do that, you know, that's the perception. So to illustrate my point of view, I told them that President Clinton came to Islamabad for 5 hours when General Musharraf was the president.
Yes, after visiting India?
Yes. There were 3 decoy aeroplanes, you know, he drove on the wrong side of the road, you know, dressed on the TV, and he flew away, you know. And I think after 2-3 months, President Zhu Rongji came here, you know. He came, announced in 1747, you know. The children and the people of Pakistan were lined up along the roadside,
yes,
all along from the airport to the presidency.
All the way from Bavaria to, yes.
You know? So this is the perception that people have about both the countries. And to be fair to them, they can only focus on a few issues at a time, you know, because there in the world there are 200 countries and they are involved with everyone, you know, and there's always a crisis from one continent to the other.
But in Afghanistan, they're fighting their longest war, sir, and I think Afghanistan is also fighting their longest war.
Yeah. No, I think what's interesting about this, and I think this is very perceptive, the strength of the American-Pakistani relationship, in my mind, is that we have a cultural affinity. There are many Pakistanis who've been very successful in the United States. When you know, we all know them. They're not people who are simple laborers. They're some of our best engineers, some of our best physicians, bankers, people who are running things. And at a cultural level, We have a great affinity. I noticed that when I was ambassador, even during these most difficult times you mentioned, Raymond Davis case, Osama bin Laden, I was always treated with the greatest courtesy and respect, and I was always given much more biryani than I could ever eat. Yeah? So there's a friendship between the people of the United States and Pakistan. I think that is something that we should pay more attention to. And what I'm hoping, with the possibility of the drawing down of the conflict in Afghanistan, I agree with you, it's a very fragile peace, and we can discuss whether it will succeed, I don't know. But if we do that, and if Pakistan can be something that we deal with, not necessarily always linked to the Afghan problem, which for us was an issue because our soldiers were there, yeah? If we can look at Afghanistan separately and take advantage of the cultural affinity that we have between our people, I think we can actually do quite a bit. And the kind of friendship that people remember from the 1960s and 70s, it's still there in a very public way. But you're right that the politics, certainly since 9/11, have led to the kind of tensions that you're talking about, and that's regrettable.
But the interesting part is that Pakistanis were not involved in 9/11, neither were Afghanistani terrorists, you may call them whatever. They were the Saudi people. Eventually, whatever happened on the 7th of October 2001, we heard that the Americans have attacked Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. Knowing that most likely, according to Mr. Bush, that they will smoke them out, they couldn't smoke them out because after 19 years, same people you asked Pakistan to go after, and you were after them as well, are sitting right in front of the table, enjoying good coffee and negotiating, and Trump calling them a good man.
You're absolutely right that this has been a very difficult and ultimately the expectation that we had, this war, has not worked out. Of course, the reason we went there was because these people trained and harbored the man who killed Americans on 9/11. Now, whether or not our response was right, there's no doubt that the Taliban is complicit with this attack. Where I think we have learned is that the idea of the transformation of Afghanistan. It has become, since the Taliban days, a different country. Is this sustainable? You know, is it good to have little girls who get to go to school? Is it good to have a country that's more tied into the international economy? Yes. But you're right, in the long run, what we had in mind has not worked. And so, as a diplomat,
got to do with their culture, sir. You can't change it overnight. You can't force them to change their lifestyle.
You're absolutely right.
That is evident everywhere. You know, it is evident in Iraq. It is evident in Afghanistan. It is
even
evident
Paris.
In Libya. You know, it was in Tunis. You know, because
this post-Arab Spring. I mean, you talk Egypt.
Egypt.
You
yes.
talk about Libya. You talk about Algeria. Right. You talk about all the northern African countries. You talk about. Look at what is happening in Syria. Do you think that the American policy or the formula is a failure, sir?
Well, look, Donald Trump was elected to pull us back. So if you are not happy that the Americans are not here, it's because they are learning the lesson you want them to learn. Now, as an American diplomat, I think America, and I'm a retired American diplomat, I think America has an enormous amount to offer. We are a large country. We have values that many people share. And we believe that we can contribute to the world and to peace among other people. But you are right. The domestic response in the United States to the last 20 years is to elect a man who is promising to take us home. He's promising not to mess around. You don't see the Americans involved in the fighting in Idlib, right? You don't see the Americans looking to expand their presence. So whether it's good or not.
Was it a policy, sir, or was it because of the presence of the Russians there and the support which was given to the Syrian army by them?
No. The Americans are saying, under Donald Trump, we have had enough of these kinds of wars, which you yourself say, you know, is the war in Iraq a success? Did we get what we wanted from our policy? Is the war in Afghanistan a success? We're adjusting. We are not engaging as we did. My argument as a former diplomat is there are ways to engage that don't necessarily follow the pattern that we've done over the last 20 years. I hope that America will continue to engage because I think we have friendships. We have power that can help people. We have an economy that can have a role. And I hope we can give that kind of engagement throughout this region and not necessarily have the kind of engagement that brought so many difficulties over the last 20 years.
If everything goes as planned, do you think the next 14 months would be really crucial? And after that, we won't see any American in Afghanistan?
There's always a chance that this president, who has said he brings the boys home, that he will prioritize that over any other considerations. Now, when you think about the situation there, it's very fragile. And I think that an American presence can be good not only for Afghanistan, but for Pakistan as well. And that none of us want to see the country fall apart. So we have a tension in American policy between the responsibility of trying to build peace in the region and the very real domestic pressure that the president is responding to say, we've had enough, we want to bring our boys home.
Now, if you remember, sir.
Can I add to
please,
what?
Please, go ahead. Go ahead, sir.
You see, right from day one, after 9/11, 26th of September, that the Americans got into contact with us, our government's stance was always this, that, you know, there has to be an equitable power-sharing formula for different ethnic groups. Only that way you can bring stability to Afghanistan and, you know, some order. But at that time, the Americans were in favor of Northern Alliance, and they didn't want to listen or hear about the Pashtun part of Afghanistan. So, but as we, as experience has taught us, kinetic means don't end terrorism. You know, the guys, you know, the terrorists, they always keep seeking a further sanctuary. You know, and so in their attempt to keep their military footprint low within Afghanistan, they started to pound the Taliban, you know, without sealing the border with Pakistan. So
there was something natural just supposed to happen.
Something natural that they escaped into Pakistan, and from there on, you know, it became Pakistan's war. You know, and we suffered all kinds of things. You know, casualties, people injured, economy suffering, and you know, all kinds of this thing. So that policy of trying to defeat the terrorists only through kinetic means was, in my judgment, faulty.
So non-kinetic means, primarily negotiations, that's the way forward.
Yes.
And they've learned it after 18, 19 years. This is what has happened now.
Yes, between President Obama's policy, President Obama also wanted to get the Americans
back. He also spoke about the closing of Guantanamo Bay. President Obama also spoke about the issue of Kashmir, that he's going to look after that. He also spoke about the issue in Palestine. Now what we are seeing is like something totally opposite happening. Jerusalem being declared the capital. Over here he doesn't talk about Kashmir. Rather, Pakistan is criticized for the human rights violations, God knows why. So there's a lot going on, and we have some genuine concerns.
True. But President Obama listened to the military, listened to the intel agencies. You know, when General McChrystal, you know, wanted a surge, you know, he gave them that opportunity to set things right, but obviously it wasn't successful, and then the government changed, and then there was this desire to pull the troops back, and so that's changing from one administration to the other.
Mr. Bunter, do you believe that, let's suppose now the next election is going to be held, and then either it could be Mr. Donald Trump, or it could be Bernie Sanders, or Mr. Joe Biden. Now, Mr. Joe Biden, I remember when he came to Pakistan, that was a very successful visit. He said that Pakistan is our friend, and he was so friendly that it seemed that things will change now. What happened was that right after that, once the regime changed, we saw P5+1. I won't call it a formula, P5+1 disaster. Let's put it this way, because everything was taken care of. All those countries were involved. Certainly, there was a U-turn from Mr. Donald Trump. And then looking at the other areas for that matter, sir, some genuine concerns. Do you believe that the continuity of this policy in Afghanistan is going to be the way it is now, sir? Or you could, you know, see something different happening in the future?
It's a very good question, and none of us really know. But Donald Trump does represent a break with the previous policies, the policies of Clinton, the policies of George Bush, the policies of Obama, the policies of engagement that I think we've been talking about. Trump is a break from that. When we have our election, we will either have a reaffirmation of this change. That is to say, if Trump is reelected, I think you will see him even more committed to not getting entangled in foreign areas, to trying to see where these things are in America's interest, rather than looking at it in a broad multilateral way. If Biden is elected, I think you will find that the policies, the advisors that you see are much more from a type that you recognize from before. Now, none of us think you can turn the clock back. you're not going to go back to 2016 and have, you know, as if Trump never was here. Trump is the kind of man who has very good political impulses and instincts. He notices when things are difficult for the United States, and he has changed things in a way that even Joe Biden won't change back. But it will be relatively more like the old system. Someone like Bernie Sanders, who is now, you know, fighting with Biden for the nomination, Sanders does tend to be somewhat more populist. And that is to say, in many ways, Sanders represents a Trump feeling more. He's not so much committed to foreign alliances. He is less committed to American military superiority, things of that sort. So the three options you have is more of the same, which is pulling back, a kind of a restoration of some of the style, which would be Joe Biden, and something which is much more of a kind of a populist progressivism, which is also under Bernie Sanders, not really committed to international or to multilateral kind of work.
So when you talk about CENTO or CETO, I mean alignments, Turkey was a part of that, Iran was, so was Pakistan. Mm-hmm. Now, unfortunately, these three countries are not in the good names of the Americans, though mm-hmm. Turkey is a NATO member, but is not in the European Union. Pakistan mm-hmm. was a non-NATO ally. Mm-hmm. Iran was once a blue-eyed boy during the times of Shah. Once the regime changed, everything changed. Mm-hmm. So it means that things change over a period of time. Your allies become
definitely,
your foes,
definitely.
And your foes become your... Yeah. But sir, in diplomacy, they believe that whenever you are there as an ambassador or whosoever is in power, the more friends you make, the better diplomacy you have. This is the general benchmark. But sir, in this particular case, I mean, regarding Pakistan, what we have seen that the problem in Iran, sir, whether you talk about post P5+1 or the latest incident in which General Soleimani was killed and then what happened after that, everybody was fearing a war or maybe some sort of an attack on the Iranians. Mm. And that could have led to so many other issues for the entire region, in particular for Pakistan. Do you think, sir, that fear has faded away or does it still exist? Talking about the regional issue, Afghanistan, we've already talked. India, you have mentioned about. Mm-hmm. But, sir, Iran is something which is of prime importance as well.
You see, Ambassador Munter has pointed out that Mr. Trump is a pragmatist, you know. And after this missile attack on the American base in Iraq,
yeah.
He didn't react, you know. He wanted to cool things down. Pragmatism, that is pragmatism, you know. If he had been...
That was a very pragmatic approach, yeah.
So that proves the point mm-hmm. that he's talking about. So I think that his emphasis would still be on maximum sanctions, you know, to throttle the Iranian economy and to bring the regime under pressure. So that will continue. Whatever military action either side had thought of, you know, that cycle is perhaps complete. And Afghanistan, in my own judgment, those fighting the war in Afghanistan, all of them are tired, and the public is tired of war. You know, they want peace because 40 years it has been going on, and there are at least 1.5 to 2 generations that have not seen peace. You know, so there is a genuine thirst for peace in Afghanistan. The only spoilers are those that have enjoyed the privilege of power in the last 20 years. So they will not go down without a fight. One should expect that, you know, that Mr. Ashraf Ghani and, you know, people around him would stand to lose in any new arrangement, you know. So that is why they'll fight. It is quite natural. I mean, one should expect that. But I think because the majority wants peace, my own judgment is that despite hiccups, etc., peace should slowly return to Afghanistan, and some modicum of American presence over there is required.
Is required, sir?
Is required.
Even after 14 months?
Even after 14 months, it will provide stability to Afghanistan.
But if they're not actively engaged, sir, what difference will it make?
If they're not, then there are chances that the Taliban regime of of late 90s will reappear over there.
Hostile takeover, you mean, sir?
Not hostile, extremist takeover. You know, right now they are saying that we will, the women's rights would be looked after, and, you know, we will not do the things that we were doing in the past of destroying statues and things like that. You know,
do you think that the mindset of Taliban, it has also changed during the last 20 years or so?
Yes, I think so. I think so too, because over a period of time you learn and you decide that in the long run this is better than that, you know. So my own judgment, I could be wrong, but this is what I feel.
Well, there's a very interesting saying about Afghan people. It's believed that they're at peace when they're at war. So primarily, if something goes wrong, I mean, they're trigger happy. But it's the last quick comment, because I was just told that we've got two more minutes left. Your comment on the internal Indian issue, sir, regarding the extreme measures taken by Narendra Modi. He is the same man who was the Chief Minister of Gujarat, sir. And Mr. Amit Shah, who happens to be the current Home Minister, was his right-hand man even then. Whatever is happening there, sir, and this is primarily a very well-planned move by the Indian fascists against the Muslims. Forget about Kashmir, all over India, sir, after the Citizen Amendment Act and the abrogation of 370 and 35A articles, sir. Do you fear something happening inside India? Because this is something the world should talk about, especially the Americans.
Well, I agree with you that these are very serious human rights issues. And if America is serious in its role as being the purveyor of human rights, as it has always been, really, for the last 50 years, this is sometimes not comfortable for our friends when we say things to them about them, but we should. And that's one of the things that has been a departure from our tradition, a tradition I was very proud of as a diplomat. As I mentioned, I was often called, you're a hypocrite, because sometimes you're working in American interests with people who are not living up to your standards. Sometimes you're naive, they would say. And I said, I am proud to be a hypocrite. I am proud to be naive, because America aspires to something higher than it achieves. It's not just working for American interests, but it's working for values. And I agree with you.
Do you think values do exist in modern day diplomacy?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yes.
Yes. But we have a president who is has changed that and is not concerned with those issues. He is much more openly espousing American interests. So that I think those people who, and sometimes have been disappointed by Americans who talk about values, who think that Americans are preachy, they think that Americans will come and tell you how to live, all of a sudden they're surprised when the Americans are quiet. This is what our new administration is. It's not an administration that talks a lot about human rights in, say, Saudi Arabia, when a journalist is killed, or in India, or in China, when a million Muslims are in camps. We're not doing as much of that as we should. And I'm sorry to hear that, because as a diplomat, I was very proud to represent human rights.
Well, I think that is one of the most important areas, and one should definitely talk about it. And obviously, when we talk about Kashmir, we cannot forget what's going on in Palestine, sir. The way their lands have been taken over, Jerusalem being declared the capital now, this is going to create a lot of problems there as well. Mm-hmm. And I think the Americans really need to play a very positive role there as well. Because when you look at a country which is so huge, so influential, so powerful, then a lot of expectations are also drawn, sir.
Well, just do concentrate on the fact that the American people have chosen to elect what I think my colleague has called a pragmatist. He's a different kind of president than we've had in the past. So on all those issues you've mentioned, you can expect it'll be somewhat different than it was in the past.
Well, let's see, sir, if this man is elected again. I mean, the next 4 or 5 years would be very interesting, and I hope peace prevails, because I think if he's a global leader, this is what the most important area is, peace, and it should prevail all over, sir. And obviously, other areas are also equally important. But anyway, Excellency, thank you so much, sir, for taking out your time and being here in our show. Sir, it was a pleasure having you as well. Thank you so much, gentlemen. And that's all we have for this week. I'll see you, inshallah, on Monday at 8 o'clock. Till then, you take good care of yourself. Khuda hafiz from our side.